Welcome to Math 30S Supplied, Week 5. It's mostly systems of linear equations. We're going to start some personal finance units too, how your paycheck works and deductions and stuff like that. But mostly systems of equations. So here was assignment Charlie-2. And we get you graphing stuff. Hopefully you remember how to graph lines. That's called the y-intercept, the number at the constant at the end of a equation when it's written with y equals some number times x plus some number. The number at the end in that form is the y-intercept. So you know that's on the line. And the number in front of the x, when it's written in this form, with the y all by itself, is called the slope. And slope is rise divided by run. Hope this isn't news to everybody. So you know you got your intercept point. So every time you go 3 to the right, you go up 2. Make another point. It's just like going up the stairs. That's why stairs have risers and runners, by the way. And you could make another, or you could go, instead of going 3 to the right and up 2, you could go 6 to the right and up 2. Surprise, surprise. That will be the exact same slope. So whether you take your stairs 2 at a time or 1 at a time, you end up on the same line. Look at the second equation in black. The constant at the end is a 4, so you know the line goes through 0, comma 4. And you got a slope there. That number in front of the x is negative 1. Turn it into a fraction. Call it negative 1 over 1. Every time you take one step to the right, you drop 1. And you sort of get the pattern. Heck, why not even just take 10 steps to the right and drop down 10? It's just as good. That way you get your points all nice and far apart. And you get a nice, won't be a wobbly line, the further you can get your points apart. So I usually don't go one step, another step. I usually like to take big steps to figure out the direction of my line. And where do they cross? Well, provided you got a sharp pencil and some good graph paper and a ruler, they cross at 3, 1. In other words, when x is 3 and y is 1, both those equations are satisfied. So let's check. Let's make sure both equations are happy. So we're checking in equation 1. So the y is 1, we're saying. The x is 3. Yep, that works. 2/3 of 3 minus 1 is 1. Let's check equation 2. The y is 1. And you take the negative of a 3, and then you add the 4, and hopefully that works out. Big question mark. Does it work? Is 1 the same as negative 3 plus 4? It sure is. Give yourself a little happy face there. So, graphing lines is important. We're going to have another unit where we're graphing lines too. Here we go. There's the y-intercept. There's the slope. It's got a negative 2 slope. It's going to go down to the right pretty steeply. Every time you take one step to the right, so every time you run to the right by 1, it rises negative 2. So it's going to drop 2. Do a couple steps down the stairs. How about the second equation? We'll do it in green. That negative 5 is the y-intercept. It's going to look like that. Where do they cross? Negative 2, comma, negative 3. And correction, 2, comma, negative 3. So an x of 2 and a y of 3 make both of those equations true, or happy, or satisfied. Now here's a sneaky one. Now I'm giving you another form of the line. The very first one was easy, right? Y equals 2x. It's just telling you the y is double whatever the x is. It's got a zero intercept, doesn't it? You can just picture a plus zero at the end. Now this one, equation 2, is written in the general form, or the intercept form. This is where you got to do one of those tables and pick a few numbers that you like. Notice that when y is 3, correction, when y is 0, x is 3. And when x is 0, y is 3. So there's 2 points, connect them. And if you want to try another point like 6, obviously 6 plus a negative 3 would be 3. So 6 comma negative 3 is on the line. Any points you pick out that happen to make x plus y equal 3 will be on the purple line. Anyway, we found where they crossed at 1 comma 2. So 1 comma 2 is the solution, makes both equations happy. 2 is the same as 2 1s, and 2 plus 1 is 3. It made both equations happy. Well, that's great. Here's both of them are in the, both equations are now in the general form or the intercept form. All right. So the other one will come into view here shortly. And of course, I was getting a slightly different answer because when they crossed, because I got a big felt tip, or you know, I got a big end on my electronic pen there. But here's what it should look like when you did it. Answer should come up to -2, 2. It looked like -2, 3, because, you know, my lines aren't perfect like yours would be with a really sharp pencil. Let's try the puzzle. This was an assignment. The substitution method. Here's two equations. The secret to the substitution method is you get one of the variables in one of the equations by itself, and then wherever you see that variable in the other equation, substitute it in. Well, just follow what we're doing here. Equation 1 says y is 2x, so in the second equation, wherever you see a y, you plug in a 2x, because both statements are true, unless somebody's lying to you. There you go. Now you know that the x has to be 4, and now that you know the x is 4, doesn't the first equation tell you that the y is just 2 times whatever the x is? You plug it into either one of the other equations. So y has to be 8. So there's your solution, 4, 8. If you were to graph these, they would cross at the position x equals 4, y is 8. Okay, now this one was a bit goofy, all right? This was, I don't very often see equation 1 written like that. Normally it's y equals a bunch of stuff, not x equals a bunch of stuff. But hey, whoever did this puzzle decided they want to get your brain working there. But it works. X equals 3y's minus 1. Wherever you see an x in the second equation, you plug in 3y minus 1. There I did. Put it in purple. When you combine those like terms, you end up with 5y's equals 10. So to get rid of the 5, you divide by 5. That's how you undo a multiply. Works out y is 2. Once you get the y is 2, you can plug it into either one of the other equations to find out what the x is. And it looks actually easier to plug it into equation 1, doesn't it? Because 3 times 2 minus 1 would be, let's think about that, 5. Plug it into either equation, it'll still give you 5. Yeah. And you should always check your answer. You should always plug them in. I didn't show my work when I checked the answer on that one, but we did talk about it, and they did work. Here we go again. Substitution method. Now, in this case, you don't have something isolated. You don't have a variable isolated, so you can just plug it into the other one. So you got an extra step to do here. You have to isolate one of those variables. You can isolate the x in equation 1 or the y in equation 1, or the x in equation 2 or the y in equation 2. There's 4 different ways that 4 different people could do it, but they'll all end up with the same answer. Now, it is smart to, well, you'll see there's certain ways you should pick which one to isolate. Let's just do this as an example. So let's use the substitution. Make sure you're familiar with your cheat sheet. So you label your equations, give them numbers. It's a lot easier to talk about them or explain what you're doing when they got numbers. Express one of the unknowns in terms of the other unknown. In other words, get it by itself. So isolate the x. Why just randomly pick the x in equation 2? Just for no reason. Alright, so there we go. I'm getting the x by itself by moving the 2y to the other side. I'd be by subtracting 2y. And then I'm dividing both entire sides by 2. It turns out that equation 2 can be written as x equals 15 minus 2y all divided by 2. Which, another way you could say that is 15 divided by 2 minus y. Either one of those ways doesn't really matter. And now what are you going to do is, obviously, you have now isolated that x. You're going to take that x that you just found, 15 over 2 minus y, and you're going to plug it in to the other equation. So into equation 1 then. So wherever you see a x in equation 1, there it is. You're going to plug in a 15 over 2 minus y. And of course, 6 bunches of 15, 2. 15 divided by 2 minus y is really the same as 45 minus 6 y's. Well, the video may be messed up a bit here. I probably did it. There we go. That's better. So when you do the math and you calculate for the y, you group the like terms, a little bit of grade 8 math here, you find out the y is 7. And of course, once you find out the y is 7, well, the next step is you take that and you plug it back into the other either equation, rather, to find out the x. And we'll save that for this slide here. So we're going to take the y equals 7 and plug it in. So it's the same question. We got the y equals 7. We're going to plug it into either one of those equations. All right, remember what we'd done. We'd labeled the equations. We expressed one in terms of the other. We isolated that x in the second equation. We plugged it into the first equation. We determined that y was 7. All right, now we know that y is 7, so you plug it into the either original equation. Doesn't matter which one. So let's plug it into equation 1. They both look about as difficult. Looks like x equals 1/2. And you should always check your answer. Is 6 times 1/2 minus a 7 equal to negative 4? It sure is. Is 2 times 1/2 plus 2 sevens equal to 15? 2 halves plus 2 sevens, is that equal to 15? Give yourself a little happy face there. It does work. Here's another example where you got to isolate one of the things. Now, it's smart to isolate the thing, the variable, that has a positive 1 in front of it. So, in this case, the x in the second equation. That would be the smart thing. Because if you isolate anything else, you're going to end up dividing by 5. You're going to have y equals something divided by some fraction or something. If you can, isolate the thing that has a 1 in front of it, a hidden 1. So that's what I did. I took equation 2, and I took that x, and I isolated the x by itself. So I did that by, adding 2 y's to both sides, which made it disappear on the left and appear over on the right, with a change in sign, or sense, rather. So there we go. I'm taking that statement there that x equals 2 plus 2y, and wherever I see an x in the first equation now, I substitute it in. And a little bit of simple algebra there will tell you that y must equal negative 3. Okay, so we solved for the one variable. We solved and found out that the y equals negative 3. And then the next step, you got all this in your notes. You're allowed to use your reference notes. You plug that negative 3 back into either original equation to find out what the x is, or the other variable that you never calculated for. So, look, I'm going to plug in a negative 3 into there. If I plug a negative 3 into the first one, turns out that you only have to plug into one of them. They'll give you the same answer. Plugging into the first equation there, plugging in a negative 3 for y, I'm going to find out that, looks like x is going to be about negative 4. Let's have a boot. Yep, negative 4. So there's my solution. X is negative 4. Y is negative 3. If you graph them, that's where they cross, at negative 4 and negative 3. But we tend to like algebra better, because I don't walk around with a sharp pencil and a ruler and graph paper. Now, this was a good one, too. A lot of people get confused and they end up with 0. Okay, so we isolated the x in the first equation by taking away 2y. Then wherever we saw x in the second equation, we plug it in, or substitute it. So now the second equation becomes, well, here comes the second equation when we substitute in negative 4 minus 2y for x. And a little bit of fancy math will tell you. And then a lot of people went, what the heck? 4y's equals negative 6y's? I don't get it. Well, guess what? If the price of 4 pizzas equals the price of 6 pizzas, the only way that can work is if pizza is free. So a little bit of math would show you that y is 0. Don't forget to use algebra. Follow the same steps. You're just going to add 6y to both sides. 10y's is 0. If 10 pizzas is $0, I'm betting you that a pizza is free. Yeah, people somehow do a brain dump as soon as they see 0. It's a great number, unless it's your bank account. So there's the solution, a negative 4 comma 0. Let's solve that last question by graphing it. Right, the first one's in the general form, the intercept form, that is. The second one is, well, you'll probably have to do a little bit of, turn that into an intercept form as well. You could have done that on the back of a cigarette pack. And notice that they both crossed at negative 4 comma 0. Okay, day 2. I like to warm up with real basic stuff. Because, you know, someday you're going to be teaching your kids this stuff, because they know that you graduated all this fancy math. So I like to show you sometimes a way to explain it to other people. Because explaining it to other people is actually a good way to explain it to yourself. So here we go. We got an X. We got a box with X in it, and another box with X amount in it, and another box with an X amount in it, plus 7 loose things. Maybe they're Smarties. And it equals 12 Smarties. Well, take away the 7 Smarties. The 7 loose ones got nothing to do with what's in the boxes. So you take away the 7 Smarties off both sides. So the 3 boxes of Smarties must have, well, there's only 5 Smarties left over. So if a box of Smarties plus a box of Smarties plus a box of Smarties is 5 Smarties, what have you got? Well, you got a pretty tiny box of Smarties. But each box would get 1 Smartie, and then there's still 2 Smarties left over to share amongst 3 boxes. So we call that 1 and 2/3. Ooh, you might have to explain fractions to your kids here too. Maybe you'd want to use, instead of equals 12, maybe if you were doing, you want to use 13 so you don't end up with fractions. Anyway, it turns out that 3x plus 7 is, plus 7 is 12. When you do the algebra instead of the pretty diagram for your kids, it turns out that x is 5/3, which carpenters call 1 2/3, except they don't measure things in thirds. Now let's just follow through on this. Dividing 3/4 is the same as multiplying by 4/3. So in effect, multiply both sides by 4/3. Goodness. Here's another one. Or practice algebra with fractions. If you don't like fractions, well, use a calculator. But I can guarantee you don't know how to use your calculator with fractions either. So now we're going to solve an equation with 2 unknowns. Right now, this is grade 11 stuff. If you have two unknowns, you need two equations. If you got two things that you're trying to figure out in life, you better have more than just one fact to solve them. So 2x's plus 3y's is 5. Well, there's an infinite number of solutions to that, right? X could be 0 and y could be 5. Or y could be 0 and x could be 7.5. So in order to find out what the x and the y is, you need another fact. So x plus y equals 2 is the other fact. So anyway, you label your equations. You isolate a variable if you're doing substitution. I got that x by itself in equation 2. I plug it into equation 1 wherever I see an x. And then I just solve it from there. I group like terms. Well, I've got to multiply it out first. Then I'm going to group my like terms. I calculate the y. Now I know what the y is, I think. And wherever I see that y. So I solve for the y. Now I take that y and I plug into either of the original equations. So that y is going to go back into either original equation. And it will tell me what the x is. So there's your solution. 1, 1. An x of 1 and a y of 1 makes both equations 2. True, rather. Is 2 1's plus 3 1's equal to 5? Yep. Little happy face there. Is a 1 plus a 1 equal to 2? Yep. Little happy face there. You should always check your answers. I don't always show checking the answers, but you should check them in your head if you can. Now they get ugly. If you have to isolate something, so this is the same one, but this time I'm not going to isolate the simple thing, the x in equation 2. I'm going to isolate one of the ones that's going to give you, a little bit of extra math with fractions and denominators and stuff. So last time we isolated the x in equation 2. This time we're going to isolate the y in equation 1. You wouldn't normally do this unless you were desperate. But I'm going to show you that it does work. It doesn't matter which of those four that you isolate. It will work. So four of you could do it four different ways, and you'll still end up with the same answer. Here we go. In order to get that y by itself in the top equation, I take away 2x off both sides. Then I divide everything by 3. So that tells me that y is 5/3 minus 2/3 of an x. You can see where we're going to have some fun already. Now wherever I see a y, I'm going to plug that in the second equation as 5 minus 2x all over 3. So you're going to end up with something funky like this. Oh, you got to be pretty good with fractions to do this stuff. Now, Joe had said, well, why don't you just multiply by the lowest common denominator when you get down to, like, the stage towards the bottom there? Well, that would have been smart, actually. Yeah. You can always get rid of denominators by multiplying by the lowest common denominator. But I wanted to just stick with fractions. There you go. So x equals 1. So pretty ugly, but it does work. Same answer as last time. And now you plug in to the other, to one of the original equations to find out what the y is. It'll give you the same answer. Here's another one. Let's try the substitution method on this. Now this is going to be a dependent solution. Can you see what's happened there? Notice that equation 2 says exactly the same thing as equation 1. All it is it's just saying it twice as hard, right? It's shouting it twice as loud. So it's not really telling you anything new. The second equation is the same as the first. It's the same relationship between numbers. If I said that Grant's age equals Judy's age, that would be the same as saying doubling Grant's age is the same as doubling Judy's age. I've said two different things, but I haven't really said two different things. So these aren't really any different. So you're going to find there's going to be, well, actually, there's going to be an infinite number of solutions. How can you mess up if there's an infinite number of answers? Because there's an even bigger infinite number of wrong answers. Anyway, you end up with something like 18 equals 18. if you do the math correctly. And you go, well, that's interesting, 18 equals 18, but what the heck is X and what the heck is Y? I guess that should be WTH, right? What the heck? Turns out it's a dependent solution. Turns out it's the same line. Look at that. Boom. Green, purple, they're both the same statement of fact. So you need two separate statements of fact when you're solving problems. If you want to find two unknowns, you better have two different facts. Just shouting out the same fact louder isn't going to help any better. Sort of like politics. Are these consistent or inconsistent? And don't forget, you can always pause these videos if you're using YouTube. Just click on the video and pause it. You can rewind it a bit. All right, Joe had this one figured out. Good work there, Joe. So Ray likes to canoe for his morning exercise. He goes upstream, that means against the current. Takes him 1.5 kilometers in 30 minutes. And then coming back downstream, it's always smart to do the morning run or the morning canoe, going upstream first. And then coming home is always easier. We used to always do that in the military. You always want to go uphill first, because then coming down would be easier on the way home. You don't want to plan the uphill part of your run at the end of the run. Okay, so there you go. So if he goes upstream 1.5 kilometers in 30 minutes, and downstream 1.5 kilometers in 18 minutes, we have two unknowns. We want to know the speed of Ray. Let's call that R. Give it a name. And let's call it the speed of, and we want the speed of the canoe, current, rather. So we want the speed of the current. Let's call it C. And I hope you know a little bit of physics, like simple math, that says that if you take your Ray's paddling speed and subtract the current, but that would be 3 kilometers per hour. Because if you go 1.5 kilometers in 30 minutes, doesn't that mean you go 3 kilometers in 1 hour? And don't we normally measure speed in distance per hour? And then when he's coming back with downstream with the current, well, you take his paddling speed, raise paddling speed, and add the speed of the current. So let's see. We already said that 1.5 kilometers in 30 minutes, check up top there, is the same as 3 kilometers in 60 minutes. So if you do 1.5 kilometers in 18 minutes, then how fast are you going in 60 minutes? So we're talking kilometers an hour. Well, a little bit of fancy, remember this cross-multiplying lazy algebra stuff? Proportions, we call it. Turns out that you're going 5 kilometers an hour when you're going with the current. So we have the two equations, R minus C equals 3, and R plus C equals 5. That's set up kind of nicely for the elimination method, looks like to me. I should be able to just add those, I could subtract those equations and come up with the answer pretty quickly. So there we go. R minus C is 3, and then R plus C is 5. So if I added those equations, I would end up eliminating the C. Or I could substitute. Well, we'll do substitution first. I forgot. Sorry. We're doing substitution first. Be a lot smarter just to do elimination. All right, using the substitution. Here you go. End up with 2C's equals 2. Sounds like the current must be 1. So if the current is 1, seems to me like Ray must be paddling at 4. Something plus 1 equals 5. Pretty complicated algebra, this one. So that was the substitution method. I think the next slide we did it with the elimination method, which was actually set up nice. Okay, here it is, yeah. Now we'll do it using the elimination method because it's so nicely set up. All right, so you hadn't really learned the elimination method yet. I'm just showing you, demonstrating it to you. So I added equation 2 to equation 1. So you end up with 2 R's. And notice how the negative C and the positive C cancel each other out. You end up with 2 R's equals 8, R equals 4, C equals 1. And that is called the elimination method. That is our next lesson. And then we started some notes on how your income works in our personal finance unit. So we're learning about gross income, all the money that you have coming in, whether it be piecework or salaries or wages or child support benefits or EIA or whatever. Whatever money you have coming in is called your gross income. Some people make commissions, some people work on contracts. Whatever money you have coming in is called your gross income. And of course we'll learn later on how money comes off your income. It's called taxes and other things. So here's some examples of solving for calculating rather what Jane gets paid. She's thinking about working at 2 different restaurants. She's trying to calculate which restaurant would be best. She's only going to work 4 days a week, so probably she's in university. And she's only going to work 30 hours a week. Yeah, you don't want to work more than that if you're in university. So there's the calculations. She makes $240 for her pay. And she makes $96 in tips, or gratuities as they call them. So she makes $336 if she goes to Mario's. Now if she goes to Teppan's, she makes $550 per hour times 30 hours. So notice how the hours cancel out. And she's left with just dollars. So she'll make $160 in wages, $165 rather, and in tips. Well, she gets better tips there, so it must be a fancier place. $140 in tips. But then she only makes $305 a week. So $305 gross versus $336 gross. So all other things being equal, she'll probably go to Mario's, even though the tips aren't as good. Here's a graduated commission. You get a certain amount of money for how much you sell, and you don't get to keep what you, the amount you sell. You only get a percentage of what you sell. So in this case, this guy gets 8% of $1,000. I'm just showing you a diagram at the side there. Picture it as a barrel with some stuff in it. You get 8% of whatever's in the bottom there, the $1,000, and then you get 14% of whatever's left over. See, your boss does this to encourage you to sell lots. Because when you start selling a whole bunch more, he starts giving you a bigger percentage of the take. So there's the math. The first 1,000, you get $80. And then since you sold a total of 5,000, that leaves 4,000 remainder at 14% is 560. Total $640 in commission. And the pretty picture there on the right. And here's Tim making those little plastic things with the knife and fork in them. $192. $192 a week. I hope this is a second job for him. Pretty hard to live on $192 a week. And here's Susan with an overtime example. She works 50 hours in a week, but after 40 by law, if you're on wages, after 40 by law, your employer has to give you extra money. Notice how I like to carry the units. I like to say it's 40 hours times 14.5 per hour, and the hours times the per hours cancel out. So you know you're just left with money. So her regular pay is $580, and then that extra 10 hours of overtime, I call it OT, is it isn't 1450, it's 1450 times 1.5. So it's really, what's that, 2175 she makes when she's overtime. She makes $21.75 an hour when she's overtime, times the 10, $270. When you do the math, it works out to $797.50 gross. That's per week. Wow, so that's like 800 times 5. Well, yeah, that's $40,000 a year. She takes 2 weeks of vacation. So. Mind you, working overtime, 50-hour weeks sort of wears you out after a while. And boss won't always give you overtime, so I wouldn't bank on overtime. So here's your assignment. Josh has a salary of $1,000 a month, and he makes a commission. He gets 4% of $10,000, the first $10,000, and then he gets 5% of the remaining $15,000. So he must have sold $25,000 worth of stuff. There's the math. He makes $2,150 gross. Don't worry, his paycheck's not going to say that. They're going to take some money off. Right, now here's how I introduced you to the deductions. Right, this is actually a separate lesson. But I introduced you to the deductions, and of course the biggest one is taxes. So I gave you a chart. I could have given you a stack of tables 2 inches thick, but I gave you a chart that you can read. So just check that out. Somebody who makes $20,000 a year, look on the bottom, go up. Your Manitoba tax is going to be, can you read that on the left, about 4%. So 4% of $20,000 is $800. Now follow up some more of the $20,000 axis on the $20,000 line there, and it looks like you got about 14%, or correction, I'm sorry, 8% for the federal tax, the middle curve. All right. So the middle curve, 8% of $2,600. So somebody who makes $20,000 a year probably pays, and these are pretty accurate figures. I made that pretty graph from the actual tables. You could probably even do your taxes with this and be within a couple $100. So somebody who makes $20,000 has to pay $2,400 in income tax. All right, now somebody who makes $40,000, they pay, what's that, about 9%? If you follow straight up the 40,000 there and then read across to the left, that'll be 9% of his money goes to the province, and we'll discuss where the money goes. It's like education and health and all that. So 9% of 40,000 is $3,600. And then follow up that 40,000 line there still and read off to the left. So 15% goes to the feds, you know, for like your Air Force and your Army and Navy and INAC and all that stuff. And so that's $6,000. And total of $9,600. Because in effect, what happens there is you're paying 24% of your pay goes back to the Queen to pay for stuff. Okay. Now let's see if $60,000, because the average income in Manitoba is $60,000, right? Half the people make more than that, half the people make less. $60,000, and looks to me when you follow up there, that's about a 12%. 12% of $60,000 is $7,200, goes to the province for taxes, and read up further, looks like about 18%. Let's call it 18% for the federal line there, the middle line, well, curve really, not a line. 18% of 60,000 is, let's see, 10,800. So when you add those up, you spend pretty much about 30% of your money goes back to the Queen to pay for stuff. So that's a nice round $18,000 goes to the Queen, well, the province and the feds, so that she can build you roads and airports and medical stuff and schools. And now let's look at somebody making $100,000. All right, look how he pays, or she rather, could be, 14% of his pay goes to the province for medical and school and education and social assistance is actually a provincial thing, by the way. We'll discuss that some more. The federal government's not responsible for social assistance. That's a provincial thing. And 23%, let's see, $100,000 goes straight up to the middle curve. 23%, yeah, that looks about right. 23% of his $100,000 goes to federal tax, so add those together, that's like 37%. It sounds a little bit high, but there's other, this isn't a course in taxes. So making $100,000, yep, $37,000 goes to back in taxes. That one sounds, well, no, that's about right. Might be off by 2,000, but it's pretty close. We call this a progressive tax system. All right? It's not the same as in America. In America, they don't do that sort of thing. Everybody sort of pays the same in the United States. Whereas here, we tend to charge more taxes the more money you make. I didn't say you pay more taxes. I say you pay more taxes. Notice how the more you make, the higher percentage you pay. Now, obviously, you're not going to pay 100% as you move further off to the right. It's going to level off. But notice, if you took somebody who made $20,000 a year and compared them to somebody who made $60,000 a year, all right, so notice somebody who makes $20,000 a year compared to somebody who makes $100,000 a year. The person making $100,000 a year makes five times the income, so five times the money. But look what his taxes are. He pays like 16 times the taxes. So he gets taxed three times worse. So he ends up paying three times as much for the Air Force and for the hospitals and for his medical, and it ends up costing him three times as much. So that's why you'll see this in elections and things. Some people don't like paying three times as much as other people have to pay for stuff. Anyway, we'll leave it at that. We'll finish off this lesson later. I think we're back to our, systems of linear equations, which they also call, if you see it on the internet, it's also called simultaneous linear equations.